Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Tech Accelerator event. Today, we're going to talk a little bit about limiting attack surface with Endpoint Privilege Management with the Intune suite. So we're really excited to get going. We don't have a lot of time, so let's go ahead and get right into it. If you don't know by now, or you're here, so you definitely probably do know, the Intune suite comprises of a number of different products that Microsoft has introduced that allows us to expand what would be traditionally known as endpoint management. One of the areas that we're looking to invest in, one of the areas that we spend a lot of time investing in, I guess, is endpoint privilege management. And so we're going to talk a little bit today about endpoint privilege management, the solution, how it works, and how you can get started with EPM, which is all going to be great. So let's dive right into it. So first off, I think we should frame the landscape. I mean, the security landscape is ever changing in that, you know, when we started managing Windows devices probably a few decades ago now, everybody primarily interacted with machines at work. And so enterprise IT departments or enterprise admins were able to give a sort of configuration that end users were used to. And since that was the only place they interacted with technology, that's all they expected. Fast forward to today, end users use devices at home more than ever, and they expect the same sort of experience when they come into work as they do, as they have on their home devices. Now, in the area of admin privileges or having admin rights on the machine, this is where there can be some push and pull between security and productivity from the end user's perspective. You know, security wants machines locked down so that way it's heavily guarded and safe for end users to use. And productivity usually lends itself to installing applications, tools, and experiences that, you know, make productivity or the perception of productivity higher. Now, organizations have to operate the proverbial scale here in the middle. You don't really get a choice. So your options are, do I manage this sort of heavy-handed with help desk calls and doing one-off elevations that can be pretty costly from a IT overhead perspective? Or do I give them admin privileges on their device and deal with the potential breaches and sort of attack surface that comes with, you know, end users having full reign on their device? A lot of organizations choose to do something in between, whether that's with another tool from another vendor or whether that's homemade process. And Microsoft is really looking to change that story by introducing our own capability to allow you to give just enough privileges to your end users to complete their job for approved tasks, while hopefully maintaining or keeping that attack surface as low as possible. So Endpoint Privilege Management is a solution that we developed and that we've released in March in public preview and in April for GA, where it's available as part of the Intune suite or as a standalone offering. It's a seamless sort of elevation experience built directly into Microsoft Intune, and it's powered by the same infrastructure that delivers your settings and configurations for your estate when managed by Microsoft Intune. The last thing that we've sort of done here is we've created a rich set of insights for user experiences that require elevation. You know, historically, it's been really hard to sift through mountains of data for elevated processes on the device and try and figure out, you know, what did the end user actually mean to elevate here? What did they actually mean to do as an administrator? And what was just a byproduct of that as elevation, you know, processes and child processes that are created as a result? So before we get into the demo, I want to lay a foundation on a few concepts that are pivotal for understanding EPM and sort of how we're going to use the product and develop the product moving forward. The first thing that I'd like to introduce is this notion of a rule or an elevation rule. And an elevation rule can be thought of simply as linking an app to an action. All right. So we have a set of detections on our device. You know, this is like file metadata or you know, definitions about the signature that you define in the tooling. And then based on that detection, we link that to an elevation action. So these are, you know, elevation activities that occur as a result of that detection. So there's two ways for a detection to begin. The first way is EPM identifies a process based on the file metadata that you provide. You say things like, files with this name and this version signed by this vendor, they should be allowed to elevate. EPM detects that and then immediately starts executing the elevation action that you've defined in your rule. The other way to complete this transaction, or at least to start this transaction, I guess is a better way to put it, is that the user selects Run with Elevated Access from the right-click context menu. Now, this is a new menu that we've introduced with our product set, and this allows end users to explicitly request that an application or a binary on the device run with elevated privileges, pretty akin to run as administrator, which is built into the OS. When either of these two things happen, the EPM product has client-side components that compare sort of the metadata of the file against the rule set that you've defined, right? And once it's determined that this application fits one of those rules that have been defined on your device, it can then link it to one of three elevation actions. Those elevation actions are shown on the screen here, and we're going to go through them one by one. The first one is automatic, and this is, just as the name implies, completely automatic, seamless to the user. The user doesn't even realize that it is elevated in most cases. This is all handled for the user, and it's opaque. Now, because it's automatic, we have a little bit of a higher bar here to define an automatic rule to make sure that only the apps that you would like elevate automatically behind the scenes. We want to avoid scenarios where IT pros or security professionals inadvertently give really broad rules that would allow automatic elevation on a really broad set of binaries. An example might be allowing the entire C drive to elevate. So to get around that, we've introduced a little bit more cost on the IT admin experience to make sure that it's really a rule, make sure it's really an app that you want to have elevate and define. The second one is user confirmed, and this is very similar to the built-in Windows UAC experience. When an end user needs to launch an app as elevated, they get as little as a continue cancel button to just confirm that they want that app to elevate with admin privileges. You can do a bit more, though, with our solution in that you can add some additional validation options that you require outside of just the continue cancel. Today and at GA, when the product is generally available, you'll be able to add continue cancel, of course, as the base sort of option for user confirmed. You'll also be able to add things like business justification as well as Windows authentication to make sure that the end user that's completing the elevation is the end user that you intend on the device, avoiding common scenarios like unlocked machine scenarios where somebody may try and elevate an app that they shouldn't be elevating potentially. And then finally, there is the support approved scenario, which will be available shortly. We're targeting later this year. And this allows you to have, remember that right-click context menu allows end users to request to run something with elevated access. This allows you to take that request and approve it as a support organization just for that device, just for that user, for a limited period of time. And the goal here is to make sure that we stop sort of the credential acrobatic scenarios, or we stop the scenarios where we're caching high privileged account credentials on the device. So that way, if I'm in a support transaction or I'm working with a user and they need to install an application or a new driver or something to get healthy, to resolve their support situation, as a support professional, I can ask them that one time, hey, can you right click on this and hit run with elevated access? And then once they do that, as an IT support person with a proper role-based access control, I can approve that request. And then that end user can execute it just for a limited period of time to get back to that healthy state. And then it's gone. So those are the three elevation actions that make up our product's foundation. Again, the top two will be available when the service is generally available. And then the bottom one will be coming a little bit later this year. So now that I've talked a little bit about EPM and the foundations and how the rules are defined and work, and before I get into the console, let's cover a high-level sort of rollout plan that you should follow when rolling out EPM. The first thing is you need to enable the feature, and this happens once at the tenant level. So for most organizations, it's going to involve procuring the license for EPM or starting a trial. And once that's done, we start the activation experience for EPM once that license is added to your tenant. Then we have the ability to define sort of a per device rollout using our elevation settings policy, and we'll get into what that'll look like here in a little bit. And then for most organizations, you're going to either have another tool in place or you're going to have end users running as admin. So once it's enabled on the device, you're going to want to do some auditing, right? You're going to want to see what are end users elevating? What do I need to create rules for? And once you deploy that elevation settings policy, that allows us to start collecting that sort of usage data to hydrate the reports in your tenant to show you what users are elevating and how often they're doing it. Once you have some insight into the data that's being collected in your environment and the elevations that are happening, you'll create policies that will allow end users to elevate without needing admin privileges. This includes using the metadata that's available as part of the reports, and then creating the right set of rule combinations across your environment to allow end users to stay productive while maintaining that security barrier, right? This would be the scale we talked about earlier, right? Like balancing the scale. The number of rules you create and the content of those rules will determine how well you balance that scale. From there on forward, you'll just be managing the policy lifecycle, adding or removing rules as they become required. You'll be doing things like, removing rules potentially that aren't being used anymore. And then you'll want to monitor your environment for a lot of changes, maybe for support approved once we implement that feature set. You know, what are the apps that my support team's approving and do I need to create rules for those or why are they elevating those scenarios? So with that being said, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to switch over to the console and then we'll take a look. Now that we're inside of the Intune console, let's go ahead and take a look at what it takes to roll out EPM. So first, I'm going to navigate to the Endpoint Security Blade. And underneath the Endpoint Security Blade, I have a navigation item here for Endpoint Privilege Management. When I click on Endpoint Privilege Management, I have a couple different policies here already defined. We'll go into here in a second. But first, let's talk about enabling EPM. You know, remember in the last segment there, I talked a bit about, you know, needing to control it on a per device basis. So what I'm going to do first when I want to roll EPM is I'm going to create a policy called an Elevation Settings Policy. And when I go in to create that policy, you're going to notice it looks just like every other Intune policy that's in the console. I need to give the policy a name and description, and later on you'll see I need to give it scope tags and an assignment. But if I come in here, let's look at the settings that exist today. So there's a couple different settings that are here. The first one is enable or disable endpoint privilege management. And what this does is this directs the device on whether it should enable EPM in the client-side components or completely disable them. As the name suggests. The one caveat here is if this policy is removed, we won't automatically remove the EPM components because we want to avoid mass provision and reprovisioning scenarios as that may be disruptive to the business. Think about a scenario where an admin might make a targeting mishap and remove a device from a group, something like that. The next item here is sending data to Microsoft, and this is used for reporting. On our documentation page, which is linked all over the place on blogs and will probably be part of this video, is the data that we collect and how we use it for EPM. This controls whether your device will use any data as part of the EPM scenario at all, yes or no. So if I select yes here, you'll notice that I have a reporting scope down below. This reporting scope controls how much data is collected. So as the minimal amount of data is just diagnostic data. And this is data that we use to make sure that the EPM client-side components are healthy and to make sure that everything's running smoothly for you in your environment. The next notch up will be the diagnostic data and managed elevations only option. And this allows you to only send us reporting data about the diagnostics, again, of the client-side components, as well as the managed elevations or elevations that EPM completes on behalf of standard users in your environment. The last one is all endpoint elevations. And this is where we'd like most enterprises to be because this gives you not only the diagnostic data, but also gives you data about all elevations that happen on the device, regardless of if they happen through the EPM tooling or not. This really gives you the richest set of data. It's important to note that all of this elevation data is stored in your tenant and it is governed underneath the same data protection policies as the rest of the Intune data that you use as part of your organization. The last section here is on default elevation response. And what default elevation response does is it controls the behavior of the EPM client-side components. If an end user explicitly asks for an application to elevate, but that application doesn't have a rule. So by default, there's default behavior built into the client. As of this recording, that default behavior is deny all. And in the future, when support approved is released, the default behavior will be support approved. This allows you to explicitly define that behavior. So whether we just deny the request if there's no elevation rule available, or whether we allow that elevation to complete without the rule being present, but maybe require some additional user confirmation options. Those things could be something like business justification or additional Windows authentication to complete that transaction. The next thing I do is I assign any scope tags that I want this policy object to have, just like any other Intune policy. And then I go out and I deploy this policy just like I would any other Intune policy to an Azure AD group, and devices process and enable EPM in that fashion. From there, assuming that I've gathered the data and I know which rules I'd like to create, the next step would be creating a rule. Now, we've walked through the rule creation process and we've covered the fact that this is just a normal Intune policy. So for this part of the demo, I'm going to go ahead and use a rule that I've already defined, right? So let me come in here and I'll click edit. And you'll see that I have a user confirmed rule here for office setup, right? So if I click on edit instance here, we can walk through the properties and what it takes to define a rule. So at the very top, you'll see I have a rule name office setup. Then I have a user confirmed elevation type defined here. I could select user confirmed or automatic. And then I have two validation options selected. I have a business justification and a Windows authentication. So if I look down through the path here, you'll see that I've defined the file name and I've defined some other attributes. I've uploaded a certificate. I've also supplied the minimum version that's required. I've specified the product name and the internal name. And these are really important properties because product and internal name are protected by signature. So using properties that are protected by signature means that if somebody tried to change those or craft a malicious file, they'd have to be signed by the entity here, which provides you a layer of security to make sure that, you know, it is the file you trust elevating. I'll define these options and then just hit save. And then when I hit save, I'll deploy this just like I will any other policy in Intune, which is really important. Now, if I come over here to my devices, I'm going to show you two different scenarios here. The first one is one where a rule isn't defined, right? So if I look through this real quick, I am a mid-level manager and I need to install Office here. When I install Office, I download it directly from the M365 site. I've done this ahead of time, so it's right here on my device. So I'll just go ahead. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to right-click on this and I'm going to hit Run with Elevated Access. Now, when I do that, what you'll see here is that this user doesn't have a rule defined in this demo, right? So we're falling back to the default client behavior, which for me is enter a justification. I can just hit, I need to install Office for work as just a justification. Then I'll hit continue. And that will start the application running, which sort of hid here in the background, but that's okay. It'll start it running for the end user in the admin context it needs to complete. So anybody who's ever installed Office, they know that it needs to be an admin to complete. The last thing I'll show you is a similar scenario, but we have the rule already defined. So if I look at this device, it looks just like any other device, I guess, that I have in my enterprise. I'll right-click on the Office setup, which I previously downloaded, and I'll hit Run with Elevated Access. You'll see that I have the ability to enter a business justification here. And then you'll notice down below that I have a message that says I'll be asked for my identity. This is, if you remember back when I created the rule, the requirement in the rule. I don't just need a justification. I need to have the Windows authentication portion completed as well. I'll hit continue here. You'll see it'll pop up and ask me for my credentials. On the screen, I can use any credentials that are accepted by Windows. And then the process is off into the races. It completely, it just runs in an elevated context to complete the Office installation. So that being said, that's what we wanted to cover today on EPM. I hope that this was informative. If you haven't already, visit our doc site online. We have a ton of content there. There's multiple sessions online and multiple resources that we've published to help you get started with EPM. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, please feel free to reach out to us and in whatever way is easiest for you, either through your account team or directly on Twitter or wherever else you can find us. So thank you, everyone. We appreciate you joining and have a good rest of your Tech Accelerator event.